But I'm being joined now by Ada Akonubi, who is an economic research analyst with financial derivatives company. Ada, good morning. Thank you so much for joining me on the program. So it's the morning after the OPEC meeting, and we didn't talk so much about it. We didn't even talk about it at all the last time you were here. But what do you make of the decision? It was actually expected, though.
Well, OPEC actually shocked the world. I mean, it shocked many skeptics that thought that they were going to, you know, leave production as it is. However, this is, you know, this is a very significant step in terms of reducing production. And this is, you know, they haven't done this for over a decade. It just shows that Saudi Arabia was quite keen and desperate to for the market rebalancing. So now what we need to understand that this is an oligopoly structure where there are very few sellers and many buyers and a price leader. And OPEC is trying to reinstate itself as a de facto price leader of the cartel. So it is a welcome environment. It is a welcome decision. And but then for this deal to be successful, non-OPEC members have to be included in the deal. And non-OPEC members will actually reduce production by 600,000 barrels per day, while OPEC will reduce production by 1.2 million barrels per day. So the issue now is compliance. Will they actually stick to this? And if not, and again, within a cartel, there has to be some sort of discipline. So if anyone goes above the quota, the whole deal will crumble. So this is something we have to watch for the next 6 months. And after 6 months, they're going to revisit this again and know if they're going to carry on or if it's going to be adjusted.
But then you see, the tendency is that you'll have more players wanting to come into the market. Yes. So at a time like this, some say that high prices may encourage more U.S. oil drillers. Do you agree?
Well, if you look at for the first half or second half of 2016, we've seen that U.S. oil rig counts have increased on a steady basis. So what happens is if oil prices go back up, this could encourage more U.S. drillers back into the field. But then, who knows? There are negotiations, there are meetings that go on. The new president is going to come into power January 2017, and we'll probably take you from there. But there's a chance that we'll have more shale producers back on board.
But for Nigeria, you know, at a time like this, we're still struggling to meet up to our production quota of 2.2 million. It's dropped, of course, from 2.2. Sometimes we have 1.9, sometimes 1.4 because of constant vandalism. So Nigeria, Iran, and Libya were actually exempt from this production cut. But that doesn't mean that we are actually exempt from what goes on a global scale in terms of how the crude oil is priced on a daily basis. This morning, we're seeing oil prices way above 50, hovering around almost $52 per barrel. But for how long can this be sustained?
Well, I think this is good news for Nigeria, seeing that OPEC, Saudi Arabia, had to accommodate some major producers that had that are going through some sort of a political or geopolitical tension within. So what happens is Nigeria's production will still remain the same. They are allowed to go back to previous production levels. So they will actually take advantage of higher prices and no cut in their production, which is good for our revenue as it is. So that means we're going to see some sort of convergence between our exports and our imports, so that wide the spread will actually begin to come together, and that will encourage, or that will give us a better chance in terms of our borrowing from the international market, and it is good for Nigeria as it is. But I just hope it is sustained. And again, if this trickles down into our currency, what we're going to see is that we're not going to see seeing that our currency would actually appreciate is very optimistic. What we're going to see is some sort of slowdown in how much the currency devaluates.
But so what do you think will be next now? Taking a look at how global players seem to have, you know, positioned themselves, Russia is agreeing to a production to cut production by 300,000 barrels per day, and like you rightly mentioned, the only way this new deal will succeed is if everybody actually, you know, stays in check and doesn't go outside, you know, on contrary. But if they do, what should happen? What do you think should happen? Should definitely there will be punishments meted out?
Well, I still think that there's still some sort of internal meetings going on. I'm not very sure, but if if anyone defaults in terms of how much they are going to produce, I guess there are consequences for that. But then there's a very huge risk. And again, if non-OPEC members will cut down production by 600,000 barrels per day, and Russia has agreed to cut down 300,000 barrels per day, what about the other non-OPEC players? Who's going to get what? So it is something that is still building up, and we'll probably see full details going forward.
So oil prices, as I already mentioned, are hovering around $52 per barrel. How much higher do you think it will go? Do you think that this is just a knee-jerk reaction from investors? And of course, you know, we have good oil prices, it actually trickles into the currency, so we'll also see the dollar going stronger as well. But for how long do you think this will last?
Well, the increase in oil prices may be just for the medium term, as a lot of investors are still sitting back to see if this deal, if there's actually going to be some sort of compliance between the members, because this is the first time they've made an agreement and they've actually, you know, faltered in terms of...
And they still have the December 9 meeting with the non-OPEC members, so of course, coming up. So depending on how that plays out.
Exactly. Yeah, so a lot of investors actually is sitting back to see. And again, like I said earlier, this is for 6 months. So after 6 months, it could be reviewed, it could be extended, or they could go back to the drawing board and restructure a lot of things. But for now, countries have to take advantage of oil prices above $50 per barrel, and which is good for Nigeria as it is right now. So what it does is that it kind of reduces the uncertainty premium that we're having as it is, and it shows some sort of growth or positive development in the oil sector, and you know, we rely heavily on oil export revenues.
So right now, the 2017 budget will be presented by the president next week, and in the oil benchmark is $42.50 a barrel, and we're having oil prices hovering around 48 now because of this decision by OPEC. It's at 52. Do you think that the oil benchmark should be reviewed from 42.50, maybe reviewed downwards, to see how much more money we can get from this this largesse, if you like to call it, in the global oil markets?
Well, I think the benchmark as it is quite, it's in the right place. It's not overboard and it's not below. So, but this is something that we'll continue to monitor, and there's going to be a couple adjustments along the way. So $42 per barrel, it's fine. If oil prices go above $50 per barrel, I mean, there's some sort of accretion for us there. But I think it's fine as it is. Things change, they go back to the drawing board, there's going to be a lot of review. So for now, we just, you know, carry on as we see it.
But some actually say that, you know, there should be a downward review, especially, as I already pointed out, in light of development in the global oil markets. Getting more money to save is not such a bad idea. So maybe you have that coming down to about $35 per barrel for the benchmark for oil price, especially if you know that at the end of the day you're going to have some major players coming into the market, and investors being very finicky, as you know, if you like to call them, that could, you know, push oil prices way, way down. Some are actually projecting that oil prices could drop to as low as $30 per barrel.
Well, for 2017, there are two scenarios. When Donald Trump comes into play, his energy, he wants the U.S. to be energy dependent. At the same time, we're seeing growth in China. So the manufacturing PMI in China actually rose for the highest in about 2-3 years. So that's good. That means some sort of activity in China is picking up. And the OECD stockpiles are actually decreasing. So we forecast that in 2017, there's going to be global there's going to be a better performance in global growth, and what that means is there's going to be more demand for oil. So if there's more demand for oil, we know that supply that kind of gives some sort of equilibrium. But then there's still a lot of uncertainties. 2017, we're not sure what happens. There could be geopolitical tensions. Things can go as we don't expect. So it is something that we just have to keep monitoring. For OPEC shocked the world, like I said, by agreeing to a production cut, and most analysts thought that they were going to falter as usual. So it's just something I'll have to keep watching to know the way forward.
All right, thank you so much, Ada, for coming on the program this morning. Of course, sharing your perspectives with us with regards to development around the OPEC November meeting, where the group decided to cut production by 1.2 million barrels per day.